walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail me yet. The night won't last, your word will come to pass, my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough, keep me within. Sing your praise again.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet.
Never fail me yet.
still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You never fail me yet. I never will forget.
You know what? I used to think, I don't want to go on a little soapbox, sometimes I do, but I share with the worship team. We talk a little bit. You share a lot of quick stuff while we're rehearsing. And I used to think that, I got to be careful how I say it. I don't want to make anybody mad, but I used to think, you know, everything's just be fine in a picnic. On a job, or on my job, a great day at work, and then the rapture happens and I'm gone. I'm not thinking that anymore. It's going to get dark. I hate to say it, but America's not going to be made great again. It's not going to happen. It's going to get dark, but he's on the throne. He's in control before we are taken out of here. It's going to get pretty dark, but we need to remember that he is still worthy to be praised. And he has us in the palm of his hand, and nobody's going to snatch us out of it. And that goes for people that we're praying for. Play the chorus on this. Pass me now. Hold up. Gustav, please play the chorus. I have this picture up here of a young lady when she was a little kid. She did for us a couple of Easters ago. It was a song I wrote, and I asked her to illustrate part of it, and she did, and it was beautiful. And she represents right now, this picture represents to me every young person, every child that has passed through these doors. Some of them are not here in this, you know, they're not fellowshipping with us anymore. At least we haven't seen them in a long time. I'm holding this up in as a proxy, as a point of contact. You know, charismatics, we can get a little weird sometimes with handkerchiefs and craziness. But the whole point of that was it was a point of contact, of faith, a focus point of faith. Paul didn't mean to make money off of handkerchiefs and whatnot, but it was a point of contact for the people. And I have this right now as a point of contact for every young person that has passed through our doors that I want to pray for, and in particular the artist of this picture who's gone through something that's gone through our family. We've been through it. The enemy is very clever. And he has more instruments of attack than when we were all young. Now it's got social media and various internet websites and whatnot to just attack people, attack young people. Whether it be bullying, whether it be the false images that are shown, the perfect people when nobody's perfect, and you try to measure up to that, when the Lord just loves us as we are. He changes us, doesn't leave us the way we are, but he loves us as we are. He loves every young person that's passed through these doors. So I want to just, if we could all just, I'm holding this up. If you could think of somebody that's a grandchild, if you could think of a child that's in your life, just we're going to focus on prayer for them right now. Okay. Hallelujah. Father, some of us have wayward adult children. Some of us have grandchildren. Some of us have friends and neighbors who have children that we've been praying for a long time. Some recent crises have popped up. The enemy is on the move. But Lord, that's when you show your best work. And Father, I'm asking you on behalf of every young person that has passed through these doors, no matter where they are right now, that you will move by your precious Holy Spirit in a mighty way and bring them to you, bring healing, bring restoration. Those that have that are surrounded by bad influences, that you get those people out of their life. If they're addicted to things, God, that you break the chains of addiction. Father God, if there's witchcraft, if there's just demonic attacks, just ask you, Lord, to combat that in Jesus' name. May the Lord rebuke Satan and all his cohorts. All his schemes, all his plans will fall back on his head in the name of Jesus. The very thing that the enemy meant for evil, Father God, we ask you that you would turn it around for good, and that the testing that these children are going through would turn into a testimony, and that they would bring many young people to you through what you will do for your praise, for your glory, for your honor, that, Lord, when we stand before you in glory, they will be right next to us, praising and worshiping you, glorified. Thank you, Father. Thank you in advance, Lord. Even if we don't see it now, even if it doesn't look good now, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do. You're the God of the impossible, and we're trusting you. We may not feel it, but we trust you. You're a good God. We thank you, Lord, in advance. In Jesus' name, amen.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at the throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Trusting only in thy merit, would I see thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit. Save me by thy grace. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art your calling. Do not pass me by.
May my cry come before you, Lord. May my prayers reach unto the sky. May my lips overflow with praise. May my tongue sing of your word. May my cry come before you, Lord. May my prayers reach unto the sky. May my lips overflow with praise. May my tongue sing of your word.
Thou the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me.
There's just some problems only God can fix. All my trials wore me down to this. I've seen it happen time and time again. There's just some problems only God can fix.
There's just some battles flesh and blood can win. There'll be some moments that just don't make sense. I can't see it now, but I'm still convinced. There's just some problems only God can fix. That I can't explain. I found a healing hidden in my pain.
I know a dead man that once robbed a grave.
Hallelujah.
I've seen a breakthrough and I will again.
Still a strong tower, ooh, 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 ooh. Someone let the people go. God makes it possible. No weapon will prosper. Still a strong tower, still a strong tower. My refuge, my fortress. Still a strong tower, still a strong tower. My helper, defender. Still a strong tower, still a strong tower. Ooh, 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 ooh. Someone let the people know God makes it possible. No weapon will prosper. Still a strong tower, still a strong tower. Not by power, not by might, by the Spirit of the living, Spirit of the living God. Not by battle, not by fight, by the Spirit of the living.
Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As well as you that are online. Our scripture reading today is Psalm 119, 148 through 152. If we all could please stand. Thank you for reminding me. And it reads as follows. My eyes are awake through the night watches, that I may meditate on your word. Hear my voice according to your loving kindness, O Lord. Receive me according to your justice. They draw near and follow after wickedness. They are far from your law. You are near, O Lord, and your commandments are who? Concerning your testimonies, I have known, you bounded to him forever. Amen. And we may dismiss our children. Thank you.
Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Welcome. So glad you're here. Happy Grandparents' Day. If you didn't know that, today is Grandparents' Day. And I think that falls in line with what Johnny was sharing earlier. And thank you for that, Johnny. I appreciate your heart in that. We all have hearts for our children, for our grandchildren, for those that are hurting, for those that are not walking with the Lord. Our prayers are continual. You know, I often think of the parable of the unjust judge. You know, we continue to come and you knock and you ask, and the judge may say, no, don't want to deal with it. But we don't serve a God who has that attitude. But in relation to that parable, we continue to come. We continue to knock. We continue to seek. We continue to ask. God hears our prayers. Now, we live in a fallen world. We live in a world of decisions. People have to make decisions. People have to make choices. God won't override those. God won't override the choices. What he will do is he'll give you every opportunity to make the right choice. And as we pray and we continue to seek, I believe he's knocking on the doors of the lost. He's knocking on the doors of those loved ones. He's knocking on the doors of those in our families and those that are hurting, those that are going through difficult times. He's intervening in every way. And what we pray is that he will continue that intervention, but we also pray that those that are not responding right now would soften their hearts to hear the truth, to walk in that truth, to receive that truth, and to be changed by that truth, because that truth, who is Jesus? He's the truth. He will set you free. And when you're free in him, you're free indeed. You're free from the bondage of this world. You're free from the bondage of the pain, the suffering. I mentioned that this morning in our prayer room. You know, many times people want to know why God allows. If God is a loving God, why does he allow suffering? Why didn't he? Could he not have created a world that just didn't have suffering in it? Yeah, he could have. But we'd all be programmed. We'd all be programmed. He loved us enough to come down in the midst of the suffering and interject himself into the suffering and became suffering. He suffered for us. He took our sin, one who knew no sin, upon himself. He became sin. Now that's a loving God. That's a loving God. And he loves each of us, and he loves our children, he loves our grandchildren, he loves those in our lives that are not walking with him. And he wants that relationship, he wants that relationship, he doesn't want religion. He wants to know you, and wants you to know him. And that's the God that we serve. And I praise him for that. I praise him for that. We're going to continue our study in Ephesians chapter 5 today. We're going to pick up in verse 7. Our title this morning is Awaken and Take a Stand. Father, we ask that you speak to us this morning. Our hearts are full today. I sense a heaviness, but I also sense your spirit amongst us, Lord. In the midst of heaviness, your spirit resides. Your spirit brings us the comfort, brings us the strength, brings us the hope, And we stand upon you this morning, Lord. We stand upon your word, and we stand in our relationship with you, knowing that you have all the answers, and you see the big picture, and you're working on our behalf as well as those in our families' behalf, Lord. So we ask that you just move in a mighty way among your people today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in our last study, we looked at what it meant to be imitators of God. Jesus gave us the example of what that looks like when he said over and over that he came to do the Father's will, not his own. To be an imitator of God basically means that we die to ourselves and submit ourselves to his will. Let his will be done. That's what it means to be imitators of God. Jesus did that, showed it to us. And it's a key for us to all walk out today in our relationship with Jesus. Luke 9, 23 through 24, he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Now those almost sound like opposite words, don't they? I mean, how can that be? If you desire to save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you lose your life for his sake, you'll save it. And all this is really speaking of is in the spiritual realm, that our lives are hidden away in him. When we deny ourselves, when we go after him, we take up that cross daily, meaning that we die to ourselves daily, that we come before him every day and say, God, take this flesh. I give you this flesh. I give it to you. I want to die to it today. And I put it upon this cross of suffering. I hang it there, Lord, and say, I don't want this anymore. I want to walk in you, and I want to live in you, and I want to follow you. And that's when we find our life. That's where we find our hope. It's when we wake up in the morning and in the day, and we're going on about how we can do this for ourselves and how we can fix our problems and how we know that we've got this big thing coming up and we can deal with it by doing these things. And it's all about how we want to solve our own problems and the problems around us. And God is saying, you can't. You can't. This fallen world that we reside in the physical sense, will keep you in bondage if you're still trying to solve your problems in the worldly ways. You'll find yourself in bondage, not freedom. Because we don't have the ability to fix our problems. All we have the ability to do is make more. And it's the same way in our governmental system. It's the same way in everything that operates around us. You can't name anything, any corporation, any government entity that is not trying to solve problems that they can't solve. They create more. And that's why we don't look to them as being our hope. Whatever side of the aisle you're on, they're not our hope. Our hope is in Jesus. Our hope is in him. If we truly love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we'll learn to die to ourselves because he will change the desires within us. He gives us those new desires. The old desires, the old flesh will pass away. The new will arise within us. And Paul told us that those who practice the old sinful lifestyle will not inherit the kingdom of God. Only those who are abiding in Christ are children of God. That's the other thing we've discussed many times. There are people in the world say, oh, we're all God's children. No, we're not. If you abide in Christ, if you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you have understood that your sinful nature would never get you to heaven, only through Jesus is the door available for you, then you're a child of God. Otherwise, you're not. You're part of God's creation, yes, but you're not his child. Unless you're adopted in, and you're only adopted in through Jesus Christ, the blood that he shed for us. And only the children of God are the heirs of God. The world and around us, they're not heirs of God. Only those who are abiding in Christ. Now finally, we looked at the fact that there are false teachers in the church today. And these are bringing confusion, distractions, and deceit to many people. They're pulling them out of relationship back into religion. They're putting them back into bondage. They're putting them into focusing on the blessings and the things of this world, as though this world is what you're supposed to get everything out of. God blesses us in this world, don't get me wrong. But there are far more blessings in the spiritual realm than there are in the physical realm. And if our focus is only on what I can get for today, and my Santa Claus God is going to give it to me, then you're in the wrong place. That's false teaching. It's deception. And many are sucked into it. And there's been a lot of damage to the body of Christ. Their judgment will come. False teachers' judgment, it's coming. But we as believers today, we need to be alert. We need to be studying God's Word. We need to be asking for wisdom, for understanding, and discernment to be able to identify the false teaching when we hear it. And this is what leads us to our study this morning. We're going to look at how we're the light in the darkness. And we need to be alert and awake as that light in this darkness. We need to be walking in the wisdom of the Word and in the power of the Holy Spirit. So let's begin Ephesians chapter 5, verse 7. Now, I want to just preface this real quick. This part of this may be a difficult message this morning. And that's something I want to prepare you for. I want you to process this through the Holy Spirit and through the Word. But there are some things in this message this morning that I'm going to talk about that may be difficult for us as parents, as believers with family members, others that are practicing things that are not godly. And we're going to look at those things. Ephesians 5, verse 7. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were once darkness. Notice it says you were once darkness. It doesn't even say you were once in darkness. You were once darkness, but now you're light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light. For whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore he says, awake, you who sleep. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the fear of God. So, as we came through our study last week, and Paul gave us some examples of those that practice certain things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then he also talked about the false teachers who will feed that to the people and keep them in bondage to the things that are not of God. Verse 7 tells us that we're not to be partakers with them. Well, who is them that Paul is talking about? Well, them or they are those who are practicing or walking in the sinful fleshly nature, who believe they're okay with God. They're the ones who have in some ways expressed a relationship with God or understanding of God. They've been taught the things of God. They've been taught about Jesus. They know the truth about these things, but yet somewhere in their life, because of their fleshly desires, whatever it may be, it has consumed them to the point to where they believe that they're okay doing the things that they do because they feel like it's right. It feels good. It's what I want. It's what I desire. How can my desires be wrong? There's an old country song. If loving you is right, I don't want to be right. Well, that just puts it right out there, doesn't it? If loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. Well, that's the whole real concept of the worldly mentality. That's really what it's all about. It may be an individual. It may be drugs. It may be alcohol. It may be a sinful controlling. It may be eating. It could be anything. But if loving that donut is wrong, I don't want to be right. I feel bad now about saying that after all those sweets y'all gave me. I don't love those sweets. I like them a whole lot. I love Jesus. But I like all my sweets. Now, I'm gonna get distracted here. But they are also, the ones Paul is talking about, they're the false teachers keeping them in bondage through swelling deceptive words or hype or just allowing them not the full counsel of God, giving them just what they want them to have. And that also means that the people are getting what they want to hear, tickling their ears with deceitful words that they want to hear. I received an email this week asking for my input on a particular group. I'm not going to name the name of the group. Honestly, I don't remember it. But it's a group that was formed. It's a support group that's loving those whose prodigals or children or family members or other people in their life who are raised in the Christian faith but are practicing a living or a sinful lifestyle. And I watched the video. I went through it. Well, it wasn't a video. It was actually an article. I read through the article, and they asked me for my input. So I'm going to give my input here this morning. And overall, everything sounded good in the article as they began reading. We're loving those. People are hurting. People are hurting when they find that their son or daughter is homosexual or lesbian or practicing as such. They're hurt when they drift away and become prodigals in different ways, and they need support. This is what the church is supposed to do. The church, we really shouldn't have to have an outside group that is formed for this. The church should be doing this itself. That's the purpose of the church, is to be there, to love and to rejoice when people rejoice, to grieve when people grieve, to encourage people when they're discouraged, to love on them whatever circumstance they're in. So there shouldn't have to be a group, but having groups are not wrong. So there's nothing wrong in offering the support to the families who are going through these things. But as I read more and more in the article, it came to a story of a Christian family whose son came out gay. And they were devastated. They raised him in a Christian home. He knew what the Bible taught about this particular topic. He knew what the Bible said about this particular thing. They were devastated, but whilst getting support from this group, somehow they learned to be not only accepting of their son's gay marriage, but accepting of the adoption of their children and how happy they are with their grandchildren in this circumstance with their son who is living a sinful lifestyle. And I struggle with that. I really struggle with that. And I struggle because in my heart, I can feel their pain. I can feel their pain. I don't feel it physically. I'm not built that way. I'm not really wired to feel everybody else's pain. But I sense it, and I know how hard it must be for them to come to this place when they know they've taught their son. They know he knows right and wrong. They know he knows what the Bible says about these issues. And yet, he came and said, "This is who I am, and this is what I'm going to do." And how do you deal with that? There is where we come and the difficulty of the message this morning, but in the difficulty of the real world that we live in. How do we handle those things? How do you love your children? How do you love those that are close to you while they're practicing this sin? What is love in this circumstance? How does love look? Well, see, here's where the line has to be drawn a whole lot more clearly. The world has blurred the line. And that blurred line has now moved into the church in regard to truth and how to deal with truth and how to implement truth and how to stand on truth without grieving or hurting someone. You still have to have tough love. You still have to draw the line to say, "Listen, I love you enough to tell you the truth. I love you enough to let you know that this lifestyle will not inherit the kingdom of God. I love you enough to let you know that I cannot accept this lifestyle because it is a sinful lifestyle. And because it's a sinful lifestyle, for me to accept it as it's okay means that I'm agreeing with you. And how does that work without losing someone out of your life? It's a sensitive subject. And I know that there are some, even in our body, that are dealing with something very similar to this in our lives today. Now, Paul tells us this morning, and I'm going to address it from the Word. Paul tells us not to be partakers with those practicing sinful, fleshly lifestyles. He doesn't insert unless it's a family member. He doesn't insert unless it's your child or your whatever. He says, don't be partakers. Well, what is the word partaker? What does partaker mean? Well, in the Greek, the word is sumetokos, I guess is how you'd pronounce that. It's a co-participant. Well, now you can break that down further. Well, a co-participant would be one that's with that person practicing that lifestyle. Really? A co-participant is one who is accepting of that lifestyle. A co-participant is one who is saying, okay, that's who you say you are, I'm just going to accept it. That's who you are and way you believe, and now we have this whole dynamic going on over here. Okay, I'm going to be okay with it. That is a co-participant. See, verses 8 through 13 plainly tells us, says that we were once darkness, but now we're the light in the Lord. If we're the light in the Lord, what's the purpose? We're to walk in the children of that light. And if we're walking in the truth of the light, and we're walking as children of the light, then all goodness and all righteousness and all truth should be seen. We're supposed to be finding out what is acceptable in the Lord. What is acceptable in the Lord? His word and obedience to his word is acceptable to the Lord. There's nothing about that you can change. To accept anything outside of his word as truth means that you are not seeking what is acceptable to the Lord. You're seeking what is acceptable for yourself to be able to handle it in this world that we live in, through our emotions, through our way of not, or fear, our fear of not wanting to lose a relationship. But see, verse 11 goes on and says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. Now, what does it mean to not have fellowship? Well, fellowship is an agreement, a togetherness, an acceptance, a walking alongside of, being with. That's what fellowship is. We talk about fellowship. This is a fellowship of believers here together. We come together and we fellowship together because we believe the same core beliefs. We believe in Jesus. We believe in his word. We believe his word is the inerrant word of God. We believe that he is truth. So we accept that among ourselves as believers. Now, I know there are some churches that do no longer believe those basic truths. They have denied the inerrancy of his word. They've denied his truth. They've denied him in a lot of ways. And they've accepting of other things. But that's not a church. That's a social club. A church is a group of believers who believe in Jesus. That's the definition of a church as I see it. And so here we are in this world. We are the light. We're to walk in the light. And we're not to be in fellowship with those who are not in the light. Now again, let me make this clear. Doesn't mean that we shun them and exclude them from our lives. What it means is that we make it very clear that these lifestyles and these sins are not acceptable. And there is even a line in that. Now, I'm not going to tell you what that line is. That's between you and God. This family in this article, they chose their path on how to deal with it, as being fully accepting and loving in the way that the world would say love. But again, Paul says have no fellowship, but we're supposed to be exposing the sin. For it is shameful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. So to be in fellowship with them, accepting their behavior as okay, is opposite of what the Word of God tells us we're supposed to do. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. In other words, when the truth is in you, and you are walking in that truth, and you're walking in that light, and you are living in that light, you are bringing exposure to the darkness. But when you begin to accept the darkness, then you're dimming your light. And what does it say? Do not put a basket over your light, but let it shine so that all can see. Now, what this is applying to here, it's applying to our fleshly nature. See, God is calling us to die to our human fleshly nature side. And what that means is when we experience certain situations, we have to address them one or two ways. Am I going to address them through my emotional, fleshly context of who I am, what I believe, how I want things to be, and how I feel about it, versus what the Word of God says in truth, handling things in accordance to His Word? Now, there are only two choices laying there. To accept His truth and His Word means we have to draw a hard line sometimes against sin. We have to take a stand. We have to be alert. We have to be awake. If we go the other side, then we can start thinking like this. Well, but I love them. And I want to be with them. And I don't want them to be hurt by me. I don't want to hurt them. And I don't want to grieve them and all these things. Listen, they're already hurting or they wouldn't be living in a sinful lifestyle. The thing about it is, and this is a simple truth that we need to get a hold of. When people are practicing a sinful lifestyle, they are believing a lie. They're believing a lie because of a wounding or a sin or something within themselves that they do not want to deal with. And so they choose the lie to believe. The whole world that we live in is believing lies about who they are. I mean, I often refer to Hollywood, and you look at Hollywood. Look how messed up these people are. People follow them. They idolize them. But these people are some of the most messed up people regarding decisions that they make in their lives that of anyone out there. And think about it. Why do most become actors? Because they don't like the real life. They would rather play a role. And so they become actors, and they're living something else day in and day out. When you're living another role in somebody on TV or in the movies and all that stuff, you get to all day long be somebody else. You don't have to feel your own pain. But is it working? No. Drugs and alcohol are extremely high in that whole circle. So it's not working for them, but that's the direction that they've chosen. People who are in pain make bad choices. God is giving us the opportunity every single day to make wise choices. But we as believers have to be that light to those in the dark world to give them the opportunity. There are consequences to sin. There are consequences to sin. The ultimate consequence is dying and being eternally separated from God. But because of His mercy and His grace, He's letting that light of truth shine through believers to unbelievers. But if we cave and waver on truth because of our own feelings and emotions and how we can't deal, I can't let them go, I can't this, I can't that, then what we're doing is we're actually catering to their sin. Coddling in a lot of ways. And again, I'm not saying beat them up with the Bible. I'm not saying go and force them to change what they're doing. What I'm saying is be strong enough in the Lord to present truth and strong enough in Him to stay in Him. And if that means separation in some cases, then that's what it means. Leave them in the hands of the Lord. Give them to the Lord. This is something God has shown me many years ago, and I'm still living it today. I have prodigal children. But we give them to the Lord. I have to leave them in His hands. If I don't leave them in His hands, then how am I going to rationalize my lifestyle regarding how I'm going to accept whatever or whatever they're doing or not doing? So how do we love those in our circle who are living in sin? First, we have to stay in God's Word and not confuse what true love is by bringing into the world's view or even our emotional responses into the equation. Many times we don't want to take a biblical stand on sin because we don't want to lose a relationship. And as we've already covered, I understand that. But if we don't stand for truth, who will? If we're not willing to stand for truth as believers in Jesus Christ, then who will stand for truth? True love is sharing truth no matter what the consequences. That's what true love really is. You wouldn't knowingly let a friend or a loved one drive while being drunk if you knew they were drunk, and you would try to get the keys from them. Now, you probably may not be able to force it, but you would try to take the keys from them. You try to get them not to engage in that activity because it's going to kill them or somebody else. That just makes sense, right? You love them enough to say, don't do it. Parents, we love our kids enough to teach them things that will hurt them. As they're growing up, don't touch the hot stove. It's the one we always think about. If they do touch it, they won't do it again. There are consequences, and I'm not telling you not to tell them. We are to encourage them. Listen, this behavior will cause you a problem. This is going to hurt you. Stay away from this. We teach our children, we love our children enough to tell them these things because we want to protect them. The spiritual side of warning those around us is far more important than the physical side because it's eternal. We're talking eternal perspective here. Oh, well, they're not really hurting anybody. They're dying. And they're dying without Jesus because nobody is standing in truth. They would rather just roll over and let it be than to take a stand and live in light, in the light, in that circumstance. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have communication with them. It doesn't mean that we can't see them. It doesn't mean that we have to alienate them. But it does mean that we have to draw a hard line of I accept or don't accept what's going on in this circumstance in your life. Let me ask you this, and this is kind of a odd question, but if a husband or wife commits adultery and refuses to repent, but continues in this outside relationship, would you want to stay with them? No. Thank you for that prompt response. Would you be accepting of their lifestyle, or would you leave it? I think everybody pretty much knows the answer. They would leave that situation. But they love that husband or wife. Do they not? Yeah, they do. But they can't accept that behavior. Why? Well, because it's sin, number one. But number two, it's affecting them personally. Now, that's where the line really comes unclear for a lot of people. Well, yeah, but that's, you're talking about a husband and wife. This is completely different. Not in God's eyes. See, sin is sin. God doesn't put certain sins above others. We put certain sins above others when it affects us. But in the relationship with God, it does affect us. It affects us because we are supposed to love them enough to tell them truth. And to say, listen, this is sin, if that's what the Bible says. And these are not my opinions. I'm not drawing a line on certain sin above another. Sin is sin. If it's against God's word, it's sin. And so, therefore, we have to draw that line and stand. Again, I know there's a difference between a marital relationship and a parent relationship. But truth is truth. And the truth offends. The truth offends. And I want you to think about this for a second. Before you met Jesus, you heard truth. And there are many, probably in your own testimonies, that would say how angry you were initially when you heard that truth. That doesn't apply to me. That's not what that says. I can do what I want to do. I don't need a God. I don't need this. I don't need that. And look at this today. Look how many people that claim to be atheists that are angry with God. They curse him all the time. Why are you using God's name in vain? You don't even believe in him. Find something else to curse. But they're angry with the God that they say they don't believe in. Well, this is the human nature. We all have this void. We all have a need for God, but not all of us want to receive God. And so when that truth comes to us, wherever we are, most of the time our first reaction is, no, I don't want that. And you get angry because it offends. What does it offend? It offends our fleshly nature. It tells our fleshly nature, you're wrong. You're not in control. You're not fixing your own problems. You're not able to live in peace. You're miserable. No, I'm not. You're miserable. That's what truth does. It brings offense to the flesh. And if there's not an offense brought to the flesh is going to settle in and be comfortable. So where does the offense come from? It comes from God's Word. Who's supposed to bring the offense? Well, not us personally. But living in the Word and in the light, we do bring offense when we speak truth. That's what it is. Jesus himself offends. 1 Peter 2, 6 through 8, therefore it is also contained in the Scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone. Who's the chief cornerstone? Jesus. Elect, precious. And he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word to which they were also appointed. Now, that passage is specifically referring to the Jews who stumbled over their own Messiah. But it applies today. It applies today. We are God's children. We are His church. He is still truth. He is still the rock. And therefore, He has appointed us to His truth. And if we're appointed to His truth, we need to be standing and obedient to His truth, especially when dealing with those who are practicing sin. This is a hard teaching, as I said earlier, and it's gut-wrenching for many who are dealing with this situation firsthand. And I encourage each of us to get along with God and to ask Him for His wisdom and His discernment in dealing with these situations. And while doing so, I encourage you to give Him your emotional pain, your emotional responses, your emotional reactions. And I also encourage you to give Him your fears, because that's the big one. If I say something, they're going to react. And they may not want to come around. They may not want to talk to me anymore. It may end the relationship. There's that fear. There's that fear. But the truth is He's going to meet you right where you are. He's going to give you the wisdom, and He's going to help you deal with that fear. Remember what 1 John tells us. 1 John 4:18, there is no fear in love. And we're talking about walking in love, aren't we? We're talking about walking in Jesus. But perfect love casts out fear. He casts out that fear that we so often are in bondage to. Now, this is not necessarily having to be these difficult relationships here. It could be when you're afraid to witness to somebody. It could be afraid when you have this fear, well, I don't know how they're going to respond. I don't know what they're going to say. Well, I don't want to do it. That's also part of this whole fear. When you're standing in the Lord and you're standing in relationship with God, He wants you to be obedient to what He's calling you to do in accordance to His Word. And there is that fleshly fear. It's real. But He tells us not to walk in that fear. There's no fear in him, there's no fear. Our fear is in our flesh. It's not in him. Perfect love, that's his love, that's Jesus himself, cast out fear. Because here, listen to this, fear involves torment. Ooh, torment. Often we're tormented when we're not obedient to Jesus because we're walking in the fear instead of in the love. And we're torn up inside. But I don't want to. I'm afraid to. What if? How are they going to respond? How's all this going to end? We don't have those answers when we're walking in faith. But we have the scripture that tells us that we're to cast out that fear. He doesn't want that fear in us. And he also goes on in this passage to say, he who fears has not been made perfect in love. Which means we're still struggling within our own nature on dealing with these circumstances, not submitting them to him. When we submit them to him, then we're able to walk in obedience, not in fear. That's what he calls us to do. Now verses 14 through 17 tell us to awake, ye who sleep. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Isaiah 61 through 3 says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you, and the Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. He's speaking to the Jewish nation of that day. But see how that applies to us today? The darkness is over the earth, and the deep darkness over the people of the world. That's what's going on right now. That's happening right before us. But the Lord, he has arisen over us. Jesus rose from the grave. When he rose from the grave and ascended to be at the right hand of the Father, he has risen over us. He encompasses us. He holds us. He covers us. We are hidden in Christ. And therefore, he gives us the strength to say what needs to be said, to do what needs to be done, and to walk in obedience. Gentiles shall come to your light. Well, in the sense of our study today, we can look at the Gentiles just like we've looked at it before. The pagans, the heathens will come to the light. Because you're walking in that light. And Romans 13:11 says, put on Christ and do this knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. It's high time. High time to wake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. Now it's not speaking of our salvation of being in Christ in this moment. When we believe in him and receive him, we've received our salvation, the eternal salvation. But we're talking about when he comes back. We're talking about when we meet him face to face. It's closer now and nearer now than when we first believed. In 1 Corinthians 15:34, awake to righteousness and do not sin, for some do not have the knowledge of God. And I speak this to your shame. Listen, it's not our job to save people. Not my job. I can't do it. You can't do it. Our job is not to save anybody. That's between the Holy Spirit awakening a heart to Jesus. That's his job. I much prefer to leave him with it. However, it is our job to live in the light. It is our job to speak truth. It is our God to it is our ability and what our purpose is to live our lives in accordance to his word. Now, there's no condemnation in this message if we failed in these areas. We all have. That's the mercy of God revealing that failure to us to say, listen, now it's a time to grow closer to me, so we're not walking this way consistently. You're drawing closer to me. You're putting those fears down. You're speaking the truth. You're living your life in accordance to my word. That's what he wants us to do. See, the church is the holy bride of Christ. We're the light of the world. We are his children. And now is the time to awaken to these truths, not cower down to the cultural movements that have enslaved so many people. Not bowing down to the lifestyles who are enslaved. There are so many that are enslaved to sin. Even some of the ones we love are trapped in the enemy's lies. But we have to live in truth. And true love is sharing truth with those who are practicing these lifestyles without participation, without coexisting with it, without saying, well, that's what you've chosen. I guess I'll just have to accept it. That's not what the word says we're supposed to do. And you have to have these conversations. Now, where does it leave us? Where does it leave us? It leaves us in a place to where sometimes we are grieved because of the pain that people we love are experiencing because of their sin. And that grief is real. Sometimes relationships are severed. Sometimes you have to draw those hard lines. And you have to say, no, I'm sorry. I can't participate with you in this lifestyle. I love you enough to speak truth into you that you may receive Jesus and walk away from that lifestyle. Now you might say, again, there are many today that are going to say, wait a minute, what about the genetics? What about those people that are born with these certain desires? What about those who really believe all of the things about themselves? What about those people? Well, number one, Paul very specifically writes in his word that some of these we used to be. Wait a minute, hold on. You mean that certain lifestyles that were practiced, homosexuality and all that, and he lists them in Corinthians, and so were you among them. You used to practice these things. There are many believers who have walked away from that lifestyle. They walk away because they've seen Jesus and his truth, and they realize that they've been believing a lie about themselves. If that's true, if what Paul writes is that you can move away from it, then what that tells you is that there's a lie telling you you were born into it and you can't change it. So what do we believe? We believe the word, or do we believe what certain quacky doctors have come out with lately? That a man can actually share in women's experience regarding certain aspects of their bodies when they don't even have the parts to do it. I mean, it's craziness that we're talking about. But the lies continue to build, and the deception continues to dig, and people continue to believe it. We have to stand for truth. Even in those relationships that are close to us, we have to stand for truth. Now, in that, is that hating them? No. It's just the opposite. It's the opposite of hate. True hate is one who basically hides away and doesn't tell them any way of salvation. Any way that there's a hope that they can live at peace in their lives and walk in Jesus and be set free from those things. That's really hate. That's what hate is. When you really think about it, hate is withholding valuable information that could change their life and save them in eternity. True love is being the light and sharing with them, sorry, I know you believe it. I do. And they do believe what they believe. Don't get me wrong. They are all in for the lifestyle. They're all in because they believe the lies that got them there. But the light exposes darkness. and it can expose the darkness in one's heart if they're really seeking, and the Holy Spirit connects, and they can learn, and they can grow, and they can repent, and they can change, and they can become who God intended them to be, back in relationship with Him. That's what our role is here on this earth. True love is showing them the way to be delivered from the law of sin and death. And the only way is in Jesus. The only way is in His Word. The only way is for us to shine that light. That's what walking in the wisdom of God looks like. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. In many ways, it's painful. Many ways it's painful. But as Paul said, the sufferings of this world, the pain in this world, is not even going to compare to the glories that we're going to experience when we see Jesus face to face. When we walk in obedience through the pain here, we inherit the fullness of the blessings of that relationship when we meet Him face to face. And that's a choice that each of us have to come to. We have to come to this place. What do we believe? What do we say we believe? What do we practice in our beliefs? What are we willing to stand for? Because if we don't draw the line today, there are many that may die in that sin because we withheld information. Now, I'm going to tell you something. They still have a choice, and I do believe if their heart is softened to God's Word, He will reach them. I believe that. That doesn't negate our role. To sit here today and to say, well, somebody else will witness to them. God, and think about this too. How many times have we prayed? And myself the same way. I've had conversations with one of my sons in particular. I've had this hard conversation. We can't discuss it very often. Because not regarding homosexuality, but regarding atheism, actually. We've had the discussion, but it doesn't work for us to have a discussion very long because he's not mentally or willingly able to comprehend spiritual truth at this moment. But I've given him to God. And I prayed, God, bring someone in his life. Bring someone in his life that he actually trusts in a way that can build a relationship that will share truth to him that he's willing to hear at that point. And we've all experienced that in our life where our kids will come home and share something with us that we told them all their life and they never heard it until somebody else said it. Like, I've told you that? No, you didn't. You never said that. There is that aspect, and it's okay to pray that way, but here's what I'm talking about. When you're not willing to draw the line of light against darkness for in those relationships in our own life, and we're not willing to speak the truth out, then I do believe there is a responsibility on us that we're negating our responsibility regarding God's Word. Yes, we still pray, God, bring someone that can touch their heart. Bring someone into their life. But also, don't just push sin aside or accept a situation and then ask God to bring somebody. You're already there. Now, again, it may cause division. And I will say that in this one relationship with my oldest son, we do have a relationship. But it could be so much better if he would receive Jesus. And we have conversations. We can only go so far. Again, usually it gets to that point he don't want to talk about it anymore. And I understand it. And I have to be careful because I am in that situation to where I want to be that light. And I'm not going to deny God's Word no matter what. And I'll bring it up whenever it has to be brought up. It's usually limited conversation. But he knows where I stand on these things. But when it comes to a sin that God is very specifically talking about that is an abomination, we cannot accept that sin and say, if you believe it, I guess it's okay. I'm just going to let it be. Because that's not who we're called to be. You've got to take that stand. And there are consequences with those decisions. But understand this. When you're walking in Christ, you're walking in truth. And walking in truth supersedes the emotional feeling of loss. There may be loss, but think of this. There could also be wonderful gain by someone seeing your stand, walking continually, not wavering in the light of God, to where at some point it connects with them and they turn. Give it to God. And again, as I said earlier, when you're in these circumstances and you're walking in these problems of life and in these sins of life and the fears of life, give it all to God. Give yourself over to God too. All of your emotions, all your fears, all your anxieties, give it to Him and ask Him to, through His Word and through His Spirit, give you the wisdom of how you're to deal with that situation. But knowing what the Word says is very important. You need to be in the Word. You need to know His truth. And we need to love. But we need to love in accordance to Him, not in accordance to the flesh. Totally different. Totally different. The love in the flesh usually involves more of our emotions and feelings than it does God's truth. The Word, and when you're loving in the Spirit, you're putting that aside and you're dealing with specifically what the Word of God says. It is hard. Christianity in a fallen world is hard. He never said it would be easy. There's nowhere in Scripture that says, hey, accept Jesus, win the lottery. Some people may believe that. Some people are spending their last dollar trying. That's not what the Bible says. Take up your cross. Suffering is coming. Persecution, they hated you, they're going to hate me. The world is against you. But we need to walk in that truth. Amen? Father, I thank You for Your Word. I know this is a hard word, and I know there are many that are struggling and with relationships with people that are in this very thing. And it's a very, very difficult thing, Lord, to walk out Your truth in our lives when pain is involved and relationships are involved. But Lord, we have to stand on Your Word. There has to be a foundation that we stand on. And if we deny Your Word here, then what? Why do we believe it here or over there or whatever else do we want to take out of Your Word to say, well, that really doesn't apply? It's either all or nothing in Your Word. You can't take part and leave some on the table and take the rest of it and go with it. It's not the way it works. And there is a line, Lord, that You have drawn. We didn't draw it. We didn't draw this line that You put into Your Word. We didn't say what is sin and not sin. Now, many do that. Many elevate certain sins above others. But You're the one that sets the foundation of Your Word. You're the one that sets morality. You're the author of morality. You're the author of truth. It's Satan who brings the lies. It's Satan who brings the delusions. It's Satan who brings all of the pain and suffering. But Lord, we cannot cave when it comes to Your Word. Give us the strength. Give us the ability to understand it, to walk in that wisdom. We seek the wisdom of God as we walk through this dark world. Because this dark world affects those closest to us. It affects us too, personally. Satan's always throwing things. We're always trying to be, he's trying to trip us up. And our flesh, Lord, is still weak. But what You told Paul, Lord, with his thorn, Lord, You're greater than that thorn. Your strength is made perfect in his weakness. Because in that weakness, when we submit to You, that's when You shine. So we just give it all to You this morning, Lord. We give those family members, those loved ones, those that are hurting this morning, those who are confused, those who are angry, those who are in fear. I pray for them right now and pray in the name of Jesus that You come down and touch every loved one in this family, Lord, in this body, and those online, and those whoever may listen to this message later. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that Your Spirit reach down and touch each one of the children, each one of the grandchildren, each one of the family members, each one of the close friends who are living a life or who are living in a place, Lord, that is not of You. I pray that the light would expose that darkness and that they would repent and that they would turn and that they would be saved. We grieve for our families. We grieve for our loved ones. But in that grief, we also have hope. You saved us from the midst of the darkness that we were in. And I can tell you right now, Lord, from my own experience and from those I even know in this body here, the darkness of where we came was dark. So we come with hope. We come with praise to a loving, living God. We come with thanksgiving in our heart because we know that you have not forsaken not one. You have placed your word and your light in a way they can receive it if they just will. And so we pray in the name of Jesus, you keep knocking on the doors of their heart. Let us be available. Let us shine. Let us love them in accordance to your word. And we thank you and we praise you for all that you are and the power that you give us, Lord, the strength that you give us, the understanding that you give us, the wisdom that you give us. We thank you for it. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have heard God's word, we have praised him in song, we have shared sweet fellowship of few moments long, as we leave his place in Jesus' tender care. We will share his love with people everywhere. May God keep us till we gather here, or we meet in the air.
We have heard God's word, we have praised him in song, we have shared sweet fellowship a few moments long, as we leave this place in Jesus' tender care, we will share his love with people everywhere. May God keep